Today I'm going to tackle a beast of a question. Let's talk about the future of Starbase. What's needed to build a rocket bigger than the Saturn V moon rocket? 1,000 times bigger. Let's do this.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. The future of Starbase. What kind of infrastructure is needed to get 1,000 starships to Mars? What does SpaceX's plan look like to turn their crazy plan into reality? And at the end of today's episode, what are they currently working on to actually make it happen? SpaceX and their Starship project are moving so fast that it makes sense and is very important to see the grand scale of things. So let's talk about where all this is heading. Let's talk about the future of Starbase, as Elon Musk has just revealed new plans. For those that are new to the topic, this is what we're talking about today. The SpaceX Starbase, or to be precise, a SpaceX Starbase, but more on that later. It's located at the southernmost tip of Texas in the United States of America, just at the border towards Mexico. SpaceX is developing starships here. You might have heard of it before. It's an insanely large stainless steel rocket that promises to revolutionize the way we access space. Rapid and full reusability in theory and in combination can drive down costs for launches to an incredibly low price tag. We're talking $25 per kilogram to low Earth orbit. To understand the meaning of this number, let's put it into perspective. Let's take the space shuttle, arguably one of the most expensive ways to repeatedly send payload to a low Earth orbit, a Falcon 9 rocket, right now one of the cheapest ways to do it, and Starship into a direct comparison. For simplicity, we're just going to compare the price per kilogram to low Earth orbit. We're leaving out everything else. Turnaround time, capability, reusability, none of it. Just the price for delivering the payload. According to NASA, the Space Shuttle, arguably one of the most iconic launch systems in history, could transport around 29 tons of cargo if loaded up to the maximum. The price tag is surprisingly hard to calculate, as you also have to factor in development costs, refurbishment, infrastructure, and a couple of other cost producers. Still, it can roughly be estimated at around $1.5 billion per launch. Even if it's a rough estimate, it should be enough for this comparison, and you'll soon see why. 1.5 billion divided by 29 tons, and we land at a kilogram price to low Earth orbit of $51,724. That's a lot. Next, we have Falcon 9. SpaceX's current workhorse rocket is arguably a disruptive technology for the spaceflight industry. It is the first orbital-class rocket in human history that's at least partly, and more importantly, quickly and cheaply reusable. According to SpaceX's own numbers, a reusable Falcon 9 rocket can transport 15.6 tons to low Earth orbit if not expended. And the price for those 15.6 tons is $50 million. 50 million divided by 15.6 tons and we land at $3,005. That's already a considerable amount cheaper than a space shuttle was, and a lovely price tag compared to today's rockets. Finally, we have the Starship. It's hard to get numbers on something that hasn't even flown to orbit yet, so we'll go all the way conservative. The minimum goal right now is 100 tons to low Earth orbit per flight and a price tag of around $2 million per launch. These numbers come from Elon Musk himself, and they might be aspirational. So let's boost them up a bit to factor in real-world challenges. 100 tons seem on the lower end of what the rocket will be capable of, so we'll leave the number untouched. But we're going to ramp up the price tag up by a factor of 5, just to be on the safe side. That leaves us with 100 tons for $10 million. That's $100 per kilogram, or 517 times lower than the space shuttle. What do you weigh? Let's say your body weight is 75 kilograms. That leaves you with a price of flying to low Earth orbit for $7,500. You actually flying to space for $7,500. You actually flying to space for $7,500. That's the prospect if SpaceX can develop the Starship and bring it into regular and reliable service. All this on its own would be worth a video, and I might give you an in-depth view of this in the future, but for now this should be enough to show how revolutionary a Starship would be if it entered regular service. SpaceX is currently developing all this at their facility in Boca Chica, Texas. The location was picked as it is even further south and towards the equator than Cape Canaveral, the large NASA spaceport in Florida and on the east coast of the United States. In an ideal scenario, you want to launch most rockets as close as possible to the equator and towards the east. This way you can utilize Earth's rotation as an extra speed boost to orbit. Earth rotates roughly once every 23 hours and 56 minutes. Nope, not every 24 hours. And its circumference is approximately 40,075 kilometers. Thus, the surface of the Earth stands still at the poles. It moves at a speed of 460 meters per second or 1656 kilometers per hour at the equator. You can imagine it like a catapult, giving the rocket this extra speed at launch. SpaceX publicly announced in 2014 that they intended to build a private launch site in Texas. First work began in 2015, and over the years the place slowly changed into what we see today, Starbase. Controversial for the angle of development that SpaceX is using here, and at the same time admired and praised by many for the prospect that lies ahead. Internally referred to as the Gateway to Mars, the idea behind all this is to enable the human species to become multi-planetary. So even though I compared the Starship to Falcon 9 and the Space Shuttle by its cost to low Earth orbit earlier, that's just the tip of the iceberg. In the end, the main focus is not on payload delivery to just above our atmosphere. That's what we've been focusing on for a long time now. SpaceX wants to go further. They want to send cargo and astronauts out into the solar system. In a first step towards the moon with the NASA-contracted Lunar Starship, which currently is in development. And in parallel to the HLS or Human Lander System Starship, SpaceX is aiming for Mars. In an interview with Time in December of 2021, Musk gave the latest update on the internal schedule. A loop around the moon in 2023. Landing on the moon's surface within 3 years, which would be until the end of 2024, and thus faster than Artemis and the Space Launch System, which recently got pushed back to 2025. And finally, Musk said that he would be surprised if SpaceX wasn't landing a Starship on Mars within 5 years. That's 2027. That's the capability of launching and landing at least 100 tons of payload towards and to the surface of our neighboring planet. In comparison, Perseverance, the latest Mars rover and an incredible achievement for space exploration, weighed a little over 1 ton. Now imagine a Starship deploying at least 80 of those rovers on Mars in a single flight and for far less money. Now of course we don't need 80 Perseverance rovers on Mars simultaneously if we don't want to do the first interplanetary rover race. The goal is to build a colony. A self-sustaining city with the prospect of becoming the first real foothold on another planet, multi-planetary. And for all this, SpaceX needs a radically new development facility. That is Starbase. Now that we investigated the why, let's switch to the how. What is needed to accomplish such a massive project? What's needed for SpaceX to be able to keep their timeline and end up on the moon within 3 and on Mars within 5 years? Here at Y, we keep a close watch on what SpaceX is doing. We've done this for almost 3 years now, and Chief, our YCAM operator, is at Starbase 5 days a week. Just because there is so much progress, just because SpaceX is moving at a pace that's just not common in the space industry. If you're interested in all this and you don't want to miss that first Lunar Starship rollout of the hangar at some point, give us a like, subscribe to the channel and consider becoming a patron or a channel member by clicking the join button under the video or by following the link in the description. Or get yourself a new shirt in the Y merch store. You make life so much easier for us. Thank you so much. Currently, SpaceX is in the final phase of testing their latest prototypes, Ship 20 and Booster 4. They are being prepared for a so-called full stack, and the end result is at least going to be a full wet dress rehearsal. This means that SpaceX will perform every step needed for an actual launch all the way up to actually letting the rocket go. Even if Ship 20 and Booster 4 don't launch to orbit, we won't have to wait much longer. Ship 22 and Booster 7 next in line on the production schedule are making fast progress and will very likely be ready for March 1st. Which currently is the earliest SpaceX can do that first orbital launch test due to the FAA still needing to issue a permit for the launch infrastructure. Even though Starbase is impressive already, it's likely not enough to develop a lunar or even a Mars starship. So what's needed to finish the job? What will SpaceX have to build to turn these goals into reality? Mass production will be needed. Musk repeatedly spoke of 1,000 starships within the next 10 years, which would come down to 100 per year. That doesn't sound like much, so let's put it into perspective again. Since the early dawn of the Falcon 9 rocket on June 4th of 2010 and the Dragon spacecraft qualifying unit, which was a boilerplate spacecraft or dummy to prove the concept of a cargo Dragon capsule, SpaceX has built 70 Falcon 9 and Heavy boosters, side cores or center cores combined. That's 11 and a half years to make 70 booster stages. If they want to build 1,000 at the current speed, it would take them around 151 years. And SpaceX is talking about 1,000 starships. That doesn't include the booster stages needed to launch them. So you see the problem. SpaceX will need to do this differently. Now, SpaceX isn't Musk's only company. He's also an essential part of Tesla, the electric car brand that's, well, mass-producing cars. So Musk knows what's needed to mass produce a technically complex item. You need gigafactories, multiple ones. And we have first evidence for SpaceX wanting to do precisely that for starships. Starbase can be seen as the production site for starship prototypes, and soon as the prototype facility for starship mass production. And it's not the only site either. SpaceX is working on a second facility already at Kennedy Space Center. We've recently taken some pictures of Roberts Road, just under 5 kilometers away from the famous NASA Vehicle Assembly Building. SpaceX is rapidly expanding the place, and recently plans have surfaced that outline the project in more detail. Alex Rex from Race to Orbit has helped us out by creating an animation to better understand what SpaceX is proposing in these new plans. This is what it currently looks like and what it will look like once the plans have been turned into reality. A large center building to be built in two steps. The right roughly adds 29,000 square meters of production space and the left adds another 17,800. Two additional buildings on site with around 1,900 square meters each. Maybe high bays, as we can already see them at the Texas Starbase. Only this build plan would already be more facility space than what can currently be found in Boca Chica. Let's compare it with the typical tents found at the Texas build site right now and where every Starship has been built so far. 5 tents in a row and longer than those at Starbase would easily fit into this new building. SpaceX will likely build something similar at Starbase Texas. This would significantly ramp up the production capabilities and enable SpaceX to start mass production of their Starship and Super Heavy rockets. First rumor has it that SpaceX is looking at leasing 2 of the 4 high bays inside the NASA VAB for Starship integration. It's the place where Saturn V rockets were stacked for Apollo missions and where the current Artemis 1 space launch system is waiting for a rollout to Pad 39B. SpaceX means it, that's clear by now, and it will be needed too. If Musk and his team want to land on Moon and Mars, not only the rocket will need to be giant, but also the infrastructure surrounding the endeavor. So now you know the future of Starbase and how SpaceX wants to build 1,000 starships in 10 years. Mass production will be a key element for SpaceX to reach the goal of making humanity multiplanetary, and that's exactly what they're about to do. The largest rocket ever built and mass produced. That's the goal, and it will likely be the most exciting time spaceflight has ever seen. Now let's have a look at today's sponsor, and don't click away just yet. This might be more helpful than you think. Data and identity theft, traceability, intrusive advertising, or geo-blocking. All that is part of the internet and you can't easily get rid of it, or can you? Surfshark VPN encrypts your data and enables you to change your virtual location. Geoblocking is a real thing and providers are becoming more aggressive. Have you ever been greeted with a message that this site or video is unavailable in your country? Streaming services like Netflix or Disney Plus, for example, have vastly different libraries in different countries. Surfshark makes you outsmart them easily by removing the so-called geo-block from your account. Just activate your VPN, change your virtual location, refresh the page, and you're good to go for countless more Netflix and chill evenings. Surfshark is your one-stop and easy-to-use solution. Use my code to get 83% off plus 3 extra months for free and at the same time support What About It. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there is no risk. Surf with your own set of rules, links in the description. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Janis Strölein and many others. You rock! Now that you're part of the Y family, you get access to completely ad-free and early releases of each episode, and you get access to our Discord server, where you can meet the whole Y production team, including me and more than 1,000 like-minded community members, from space fans to rocket engineers. Thank you so much from all of us, and enjoy your first ad-free and early release. We can't wait to see you on our Discord server.
1,000 Bokashika.
Bad. Two-factor in development. Development costs, refurbishment. 1.5 billion delivered, divided.
Today's episode will be delayed due to local traffic.
Of the Texas of the America. 1.5. I'm doing that again. Floored and space floored.